Hal does his first triathlon today on the Do Hard Things Today podcast. All right, Hal Morris. Man, I am a little bit jelly over here.
Hey, everybody.
Got his first triathlon. Everybody else is getting all their races canceled. We talked about it in the last podcast of what are we going to do with the year 2020. But Hal went out and did a race, and he has another one coming up this – well, actually, when this launches, it'll probably be – you will have just finished your second one. But
I may try to get this one out before then.
Yep. Yeah, he probably will. So. We're interviewing him, so it'll probably go out. It'll be
that's right.
Lightning speed.
I'm motivated.
With that. Before we jump into your race report and talking about the awesome job you did, and we got Coach Katie Malone. She's agreed to stay on with us. She's gonna give Hal some encouragement and diagnosis, maybe. Depends on what you
– we'll let you – they'll fill everybody in.
Yeah, depends on how much of an awesome job it was, or – probably a little bit of a mix of awesome job, a little bit of some sidetracks, but we'll get into all that stuff in a second. You can find us on where?
iTunes, of course, Spotify, iHeartRadio, Google Play Music, and Alexa.
Yep, and you know what to do. Like the Facebook page, get involved in one of the groups. If you can give us a review, that always helps us, moves us on up the rankings. We're actually getting some traction there and moving on up in the – some of these rankings, and we're getting feedback from people all over the country. I mean, it's pretty cool. And now it's weird. We're actually getting people that are
reaching
out. We've
got listeners somewhere in the world, outside the U.S. from the tracking that we look at.
And it's weird. You know, we get these emails of people. They'll send us like these biographies of people that they need to that we need to get on the podcast. They're like agents for people. And I'm like, keep sending them. I don't want to say no.
That's
man,
right.
Seriously, you know, we're
wow.
But yeah,
not sure
to
where
be,
this is going, but yeah.
So anyway, come on podcast. Hey, we will make you a star, right? Hal?
That's right.
What we promise. That's the promise that we will. Yeah. We will make you.
I see the crowds at the door right now.
Crowds at the door. They know we're in here. They know we're in here.
So I got to tell my story. I was out riding with Reggie. And we came up to an intersection, and some of Katie's clients were there. It was Matt and Beth and Haley.
Yes.
They were parked at the intersection.
Well done.
And I didn't know them. So we ride up to the intersection, and Reggie introduces me. They say, hey, everybody, this is Hal Morris. And I think it was Beth or Haley said, Hal Morris from the podcast.
Wow.
Man, it was hard to ride.
Right here.
Yeah,
here.
Yeah, that's me. That's me. So...
That's awesome. They're listening.
Yeah.
Perfect.
So somebody's listening.
Hey, we're living proof that if you'll just have the gut, if you have guts enough just to do something, then next thing you know, people, all of a sudden.
It's just doing
people
it.
People recognize
it's just getting started. Getting started is always the hardest part. Once you're started, you just stick with it.
Yep.
We
so
talked
I guess
about
I'm
this.
Started.
Yeah. We talked about this for a year before we did. Do you take your hair down?
I did. My hair was hurting.
I was about to say, I looked over and was like,
sorry.
She did.
Who's
sorry.
This? I was like, it's a different person. We just taped the last podcast. I was like, wait a minute.
My hair was up. Yeah. My hair is down now.
And now your hair is down. So if we had video, you would see what I'm talking about. But anyway, we're going to talk about Hal's first triathlon. Last podcast, we talked about a lot of races getting canceled. But on this one, we wanted to bring Coach Katie back in to be able to help Hal. Maybe look at some things you did right, some things you may want to try differently. And for those of you, I know we have a lot of beginners that are on our podcast. We've got a tremendous amount of runners that have considered at times dipping their toes in the triathlon world. So hopefully some of this information and Hal's experience and then Coach Katie's insights will help you as you think about what if a triathlon may be in your future. So Hal, just give us the overview of this race. Tell us where the race was, the distances, the logistics, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, so when we talked last about my upcoming first triathlon, we talked mainly about Augusta, Ironman Augusta, which got canceled since then. So it wasn't long after we did that podcast that Andy's race, part of the South Carolina Triathlon Series in Greenville, it was not even on my radar to do. And I was laying talking to Jill one night and said, you know, this they got this Andy's race and it looks like it's going to happen. What do you think about me signing up? And she said, go for it, because it might be the only one that happens this year. So, I mean, that was like 7 or 8 days out. I mean, they were even out of T-shirts when I signed up. So I said, I mean, it was, you know, 8 to 10 days out. So I said, signed up and got into Andy's race. So started getting my gear together and everything for that, and got my starting time that they send out. Mm-hmm. They're sending out. I don't know if that's new with the COVID or what, but so anyway, got all the preliminaries done and got all my gear together, and so went over there on the day of. That was on a Sunday race. So part of the COVID procedures is they had us come the day before, and it's a drive up packet pickup, which is pretty cool. You just drive up and pick up your packet with all your race numbers and all the preliminary, show them your ID and check in. So that happened on a Saturday afternoon, I believe it was. So the next day was the race. And one thing I learned, is on the instructions said for you to be there about 6 o'clock. Race started at 7. So I got there at 6 and it was packed.
Triathletes are always early.
They were early.
They're always early. And they're excited. It's the first race.
Yeah. Yeah. So there was like no place to park. There was in the back, but I'd planned to park in a certain area where you could come and go in the instructions, but ended up parking in the back. And so got all my gear together. Found the transition area, took my bike, got everything set up. Being my first time, I was kind of looking at how all my neighbors had their stuff set up. And, you know, I'd looked a lot of stuff online on how to set everything up and all that. And
but
of course,
you were looking out of the corner of your eye, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And, of course, Jill, I got it. Jill helps me, too. She's done several. So she was trying to tell me how to get everything set up for transition. So got everything set up, and a lot of things I heard is to kind of look around where your bike's at. So you can find it, and when you come from the swim, I'll come to back to that in a minute when I talk about the swim. But so got everything set up. They wanted you to wear a mask for COVID, you know, while you're in, getting everything set up and around the people in transition. So got everything set up there.
Let's pause for a second.
Yep.
We don't want to take this for granted. Explain to the people, the runners, the people who have not, what you talked about transition a lot. Explain what transition is in a triathlon.
Okay, after the swim and before the bike, you come out of the pool for this particular race, and you got to transition from your swim gear over to the bike, bike shoes, helmet, goggles, whatever you're going to wear. And then after you're done with the bike section, you come back to the same spot in transition, and you transition out of your bike gear into your running gear.
Okay, all right. Yep. Carry on.
So you got two, T1 and T2.
Except in this race, they are both in the same place.
Okay. Yeah, I guess some races it could be in a different place. That would, okay.
This race is nice because it's all in one spot.
Okay. Yeah, that's interesting. I guess they could be. So, okay. So got everything set up. And the funny thing about this, because of the COVID, you had to do your own body marking. I did. I didn't have anybody there to do it for me, but they didn't have anybody. Usually, I guess they have people there that mark on you with a Sharpie your race number, and they put your age on your calf,
yes,
your age group, or my age, whatever age you're in. So my number was 204. So the first two I put on my shoulder was backwards. That is not right. How am I going to do this? So, you know, I was, you know, excited and everything. So I put a 204 on a napkin.
Oh, no.
And held it up to my arm to get the 2 and the 4 right. So maybe this next race I'll be like 100 or 101.
That's awesome.
or something where so anyway, I thought that was a little funny. So so the way they did the start is I understand there's backing up a little bit. I understand there's a pre-race meeting on some of these.
Normally
normally
to start the morning off. Everybody goes into the pool, Yep. Lines up by race number. Mm-hmm. So where you're going to start. Jeremy does his little pre-race meeting where he says, does anybody have any questions? That's yep. what I thought. Let's carry on.
Yeah.
And then he's usually someone will say a prayer.
Okay.
And I don't know if any of that happened this year.
Yeah. Jeremy put a video out.
The
couple days before with all the pre-race instruction.
That was nice of him.
Yeah. Yeah. I thought that was pretty neat. So it was, he had some good stuff. There was a bad curve in the on the bike route that
yes,
he warned everybody about. So
I think Reggie went in it.
Yeah, he did.
Is that where he
tumbled. That's where he tumbled.
Sorry, Reggie.
Yeah. Yep. So they back to the swim. So you line up like Coach Katie said by number your start time, and I was 204 out of 250 ish. I think that was the number. So I was kind of near the back, which was good. It's kind of where I wanted to be, being a new swimmer, slow. So I was around a lot of new people too. Mm-hmm. So it worked out pretty good.
So what were you feeling before right before you guys in the pool?
Right before the pool, I felt fairly confident with the swim till about two laps.
Yeah.
I got down. Well, they spaced us out. They spaced us by 10 seconds between swimmers.
And that's typical?
Yep.
At that race, that's what they usually do.
Oh, did they? Okay. Okay. I don't know if that was for COVID, but they about 10 seconds between us. So I was near the back. I probably had 15 or 20 people behind me near the back. So I jumped in, started my laps, got 50 meters in, come back at 100. Here we go. Nervous. Finished three. I got about halfway before I started feeling a lot of stress in the swim. People warned me about being excited and getting my heart rate up. It happened. Yeah. It did. I'll be honest. And there was a couple other guys that I was swimming with. And one thing I probably learned is one of the guys, he was struggling more than me. But he was in front of me, and I just never did pass him. Thinking back, I probably should have just went around him and kept going. But he was struggling too, and as well as another guy. So with about three lengths to go, we'd get to the wall all about the same time and rest on the wall. Say, okay, guys, we got three more. We can do this. We can do this. So we go to the next wall and get there and rest a little bit and say, okay, two more. So we were kind of encouraging each other. So I thought that was pretty neat. So
what was the length of the swim?
400 meters total.
Okay. So to explain that, was it a 25?
It's a 50-meter pool.
50-meter pool.
50-meter pool. Okay.
Yeah.
So a 50-meter pool. For those that, for most places will be 25 meters. That's if it's a really long pool. If it's a 50 meter pool, if you're going from side to side, not long ways, that's 25 meters.
It's usually 25 yards.
25 yard, yeah. So yeah. It's not even 25 meters.
Yeah.
So you're, if you're doing a short course, you're going across and back eight times. So that's how far you were
yeah,
swimming.
It was eight lengths.
Yeah. So it's a pretty good distance, especially for beginner. Beginner swimmer.
Yeah. So I got about halfway before I was really stressed out and doubting the outcome.
What do you attribute that to? Did you go out too hard or were you just excited?
That was both, yeah. I think, part of it. Being the first time and there was a lot of water splashing, in the pool with all those people. It's rough. Yeah, it was rough. I'd kind of heard it would be, but I didn't expect it to be that rough. So, so when you turn sometimes to, when I turn sometimes to take a breath, you get a little water, a lot of water. Mm-hmm. So I told somebody afterwards, I said the race director called me afterwards and I was extra charged for me drinking all that pool water. So got the swim in, me and the three guys, we were the last ones out of the pool. I think they climbed out before I did. So I may have been the last one. I think I was the last one out of the pool, which is okay. I had four lifeguards watching me. So got out of the pool, gone to the bike, and the funny thing about the bike I mentioned a while ago is kind of remember where you put it. I had no trouble finding my bike because it was the only one there.
There you go. That's one way to make it work.
That's right. Now, there were some, I mean, there was probably a few there that had already come in, maybe.
Yeah, probably.
Yep.
Yes.
The early ones, you know, around an hour, 10 minutes, whatever the time was, they'd probably already got in.
Yes.
And were on the run by the time all those people got through. So, you know, there was a few bikes there, but I had no problem finding my bike. So, transition, I just took my time, made sure I got everything right, and followed the rules as far as the helmet and getting everything down. And I probably got some improvement there, but I just wanted to take my time and get everything set up there. And backing up a little bit, really my goal for this race was to finish. I'd had no time, and by I wanted to do decent, you know, so that was the goal. So got on the bike.
Let me ask you this, because you're really strong on the bike.
Yes.
And so you're a really strong biker. So how did you feel? I remember another guy did a triathlon in, I think it was a Clemson one, just a few years ago. And he was just like, man, I'm just going to survive the swim. I'm just going to survive the swim. And
yeah.
And I remember him saying, man, I got on my bike and I just had no leg. I couldn't get my pedals going because of what the swim did to me.
Uh-huh.
I'm sure you were looking at the bike as, okay, I'm going to start hammering and I'm going to pass some people.
Yeah.
How'd you feel? What'd that feel like coming out of the pool and then getting on your bike?
I probably experienced a little bit of that, a little winded getting out of the pool to the bike. The course, you cross the Saluda River twice. So there's, you know, they advertise it as not a really big climbs, but still you cross the Saluda River twice. So you've got a couple long, not big climbs. So.
It's a technical course. The Greenville or Andy's race is not an easy bike course. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of turns. There are a lot of hills up, down. You got to descend well so that you can ride into the next hill well.
Yeah.
And you can't always ride arrow down some of those hills.
Yeah.
So it's a tough course.
And I debated when I did the packet pickup the day before seeing that, I debated whether to do my road bike instead of my tri bike, but I stuck with the tri bike.
Good. Good decision.
One. Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, I'd bought it. I might as well. I've got to use it.
Exactly.
So, bike went really well. I passed probably all those people that passed me in the pool. I passed them. I probably passed 25 or 30 people on bikes. And that kind of group, a lot of them, I guess they were beginners too. A lot of them had flat bar bikes.
Mm-hmm.
Quite a few that I passed and different kinds. But I wanted to break 20 average on the bike. I was 19 and a half.
That's a tough course to do it on. I mean, like to be 19 and a half on that course in your first race, I'd say that was still really good.
Yeah. So I was happy with that. And so got in, dismounted in the correct area, which there's, if you want to explain, there's areas where you mount and dismount from your bike. It's for safety.
Yeah, so you don't ride into transition.
Yeah. So, got all that taken care of, got into transition, got my bike gear off, my running gear on, and then took off on the run. And the run, I just went out and ran. I had no drama there. Ran at a fairly decent race pace, I guess, for me. It got kind of hot at the end, and I found myself taking some water and pouring it over my head kind of near the end. For the aid station, they would set out small bottled waters for everybody, where you just run by and take it. So, the run course, a section of it was kind of through the woods, real short piece, where you go
up a hill and down a hill.
Up a hill and down a hill. Yep. So, really no drama there, and it was a fun run, and had no really drama there. So. Saw a lot of the people that passed me again. So, but by the time I got to the run, a lot of people were done.
Well, so. And you do two laps of that course. Mm-hmm. So you end up seeing a lot of people, whether they're way ahead of you or whether they're a lot of times people come back out on the course and do their cool down.
Right.
So you might see, you know, the person who won the race, they might be back out on the course. Mm-hmm. It's kind of fun.
Yeah. Yep. So
those people walking around with the medals on, you're still out there pounding around trying to get to the finish.
So the goal was to finish, and I just ran at a pace that I knew I could, like, as a decent pace, and I could finish at. So it was fun. It was fun. It's cool. I came when I was, I think he said Hal Morris, Jeremy said Hal Morris is his first triathlon.
Yes.
So that was cool when I came around to the finish line. So.
So what surprised you?
One thing is the logistics, having all your gear, even the night before, getting it together, having everything packed, and I, the next one I'll know better. But for that first one, just having everything, what have I forgotten? What do I need? And getting everything set up, and hopefully in the right order.
I bet you were overpacked.
I was. Yeah. You have to think ahead, to what's going to happen to get everything set up the way you need to. So just the logistics was not a big surprise, but the swim was kind of a surprise. I thought my goal on the swim was just to go slow, steady. My thought for the day was relax and do it. But I got about halfway, and the relax went out the window, and it's like, panic.
Do you think that first half, though, I know it probably didn't have splits of that, but if you looked at that split, do you think that would be the fastest 200 meters you'd ever seen?
Probably so, yeah. Yeah, especially that first 100, I was down and back. And then the stress came on.
So – Coach K, let's talk about the swim.
Okay.
What would you say to Hal? And then what are maybe some of the biggest mistakes that you see beginners make, and maybe a couple of tips as to taking on the swim in your first triathlon?
Okay. So, I mean, it sounds like it went as a typical first triathlon goes, actually maybe a little bit better. Because you might have had a little moment of panic, but you kept swimming.
Yep.
So there is that that you can be proud of, and you got out. Who cares where you got out of the water? If it makes you feel any better, in my first triathlon, I got out of the water last.
Oh, did? Okay.
Okay. So want you to know you're in good company.
Okay. Well, good.
But I think instead of just telling yourself to relax, it's like, what actions could you have taken physically that would have made you relax? Could you have done like 3 or 4 strokes of catch-up drill to get your rhythm slowed down, get you using better form, less energy, which then would have kind of brought you down a level and relaxed you?
Yeah.
Could you have focused on your breathing, maybe? Really making sure you're breathing out all the way when your head's in the water, and that way you could get a nice deep breath in. Mm-hmm. Did you slow your stroke rate down to calm yourself down? So it's like, I always think mentally, your word relax is great, but you've got to be able to, especially on the swim where it's so hard because you can't breathe when you need to because your head's in the water.
Yeah.
I think it's really important to have actions, like physical actions that you can do to follow through those thoughts of relax. What can you do physically to get yourself through the swim just in a better place so you don't feel like you're so panicked?
Yeah. Yeah. One thing I did too is I noticed I would, training out the Y, I'd swim down the middle of the lane. Here I was hugging the rope.
Did you hit it with your hand at all?
I think I did a couple times.
Because that hurts.
Yeah. I scraped it a couple times, which kind of broke up my rhythm.
Sure does.
It broke up my rhythm and kind of got me out of key. But I guess I kind of was hugging the rope because I saw everybody was passing me. I didn't want to hold anybody up.
Of course, I mean, that the fact that you could do that and you were aware enough of where you were in the lane to move over.
Yeah.
that's a good sign.
Yeah, yeah. On the other side, though, the guy in front of me that was kind of got stuck behind, he was over on the side, too. So I was hesitant about going around him, but...
Going around is usually easiest when you get to the wall. So, you know, when he was sitting there breathing,
right.
That's when you just give yourself a really good push off the wall and get
off.
In front of him.
Okay.
Unless you are a lot faster than the person swimming, if mm-hmm. you try to pass them by swimming next to them, it especially as a beginner, mm-hmm. it's going to be really hard.
Oh, okay.
So I would recommend just, you know, push off the wall, get ahead of him there.
Okay. Okay. Good. Good. So.
And if it makes either one of you feel even better, I was the dead last finisher in a triathlon, the last official finisher of the whole thing. So I finished, though.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
So hey, it was so bad it came across. And you talk about the only bike being there.
Uh-huh.
Well, mine was the only bike left. And they had put my medal on my bike.
I just
walked over and picked up my stuff and went to the car. No fanfare, so don't feel bad about that.
I had my own motorcycle escort in the one race that I was last in, too.
Yeah.
I accidentally got into a ITU professionals race when I lived in Germany, and they put in the newspaper that I should stick to running.
Yeah,
the
nice.
Germans are very kind.
Nice. Yeah,
yeah. Nice. Well, you were never going to be an Ironman either, and didn't they tell you that too?
Yes.
Yeah. All right. So you transition, and then you get on the bike, and so what the biking leg, unless. I'd say it's probably, you think it's 50-50 as far as runners or bikers dipping into triathlon. What do you find most? Probably more runners
because the runners get injured.
Yeah.
And then they've got to do something, you know, to keep themselves occupied so they'll start biking.
Yeah. Well, a couple of things, and you've already answered. You've got both. You've got a road and triathlon bike. But for beginners that are going to be doing sprint distance and trying that, let's talk about like bike. What kind of equipment do they need, and what are some common mistakes and tips for the bike?
So I think the first thing that I'll address with the bike, we'll just start at the top because I always like starting at the top, is the helmet. Is making sure that when you start doing triathlon, you've got a good helmet and that it covers your frontal lobe. I see a lot of, especially women, with their helmet tilted way back on their head, so their whole forehead is kind of visible. And if they fall on their forehead, they are going to crack their head open, even though they have a helmet on. So I think that the most important safety tip I can give for anybody who's starting is to make sure that helmet is sitting on your forehead and covering your forehead.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a big one. Also make sure that the strap is tight enough, not that it's choking you, but just tight enough that your helmet isn't going to fall off. Most helmets you can kind of fasten in the back to make them kind of fit your head better. And helmets do come in different sizes. Like they come in extra small to extra large.
Mm-hmm.
So if you know you have a little tiny head as a woman, make sure you buy a small helmet. Try it on. Make sure it fits. Or if you're borrowing a helmet from somebody, make sure it really fits you and isn't like falling off the side of your head. It's not going to help. With the bike, usually for beginners, I recommend starting with a triathlon bike. Hal is an experienced cyclist, so the fact that he went ahead and got a triathlon bike and did this race on a triathlon bike is perfectly acceptable. But for most beginners, starting on a road bike is just a little bit more friendly because your brakes are right where your hands are.
Mm-hmm.
For a triathlon bike, when you are down in the aero bars, there's no braking. You have to get up off the aero bars and out onto the bullhorns in order to use your brakes.
Mm-hmm.
And that just adds a little bit of complexity, which when you're a beginner, you don't necessarily need.
Yeah. And this might be a good opportunity to tell if you're an absolute beginner or even a more advanced beginner, develop a good relationship with a local bike shop. You talk about helmets, bikes, everything. I know it's so easy to click, click, click and buy something, but go in and these people can tell you if the helmet fits
mm-hmm.
right. They can tell you if your bike fits right. They can take care of things. It is well worth it to establish a good relationship with a local bike shop that can help you with those things because mm-hmm. You see some stuff. I mean, don't just grab a helmet that you found in the attic and you don't know if it's been wrecked or if it's Maybe it fits
well, they,
a little bit.
They actually, after so many years, they kind of disintegrate. Mm-hmm. So you should get new helmets. Like, I try to make sure maybe every 3 years that I buy a new training helmet and a new racing helmet.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, they're out in the heat. I'm sweating on them. I wash my helmets. If I do a long ride, like I bring it in the house, wash it out with laundry detergent so it doesn't smell bad.
You treat your stuff a whole lot better than I do.
That foam will.
But the foam will disintegrate. Time, and so just, you know, keep that in mind if you've been doing triathlon for a long time or if you just have like some old helmet hanging out in the garage, you might want to just consider going to get a new one because your head, you know, when you have a head injury, it can change your life. Mm-hmm. So, and I'm just here to remind you that I have quite a few helmets that people are like, oh, those helmets look good. And I'm like, yeah, but I crashed in it. So it's garbage. Yeah. I just save them to take parts off of.
And it can happen. And it can happen. I mean, for you beginners, gosh, you remember when I had the worst injury I've had on a bike at all was we were riding and man, we were probably doing 15 miles. Not me. We weren't going fast at all.
Mm-hmm.
And there was another beginner. Two beginners, well, one beginner friend, and they got together and just laid their bike down and like jumped away from it, and I hit it, and I went straight
over
and hit my head, and we went to eat, we went to Mexican after that, and I just started getting a headache and started getting queasy. Well, I had a concussion, and there's like 3 days of my life I don't remember. I mean, I don't remember anything about them. You know, and that was a slow, not a high speed thing. And so, you know, you need to make sure you got the right protection on your body whenever you're.
One thing on the bike, my bike section, I did I know nutrition.
I have a few questions I want to ask you about your bike. So go on.
Yeah, you know, sprint nutrition is not a big as deal as. It can be, I guess it depends on the person, but I did a gel on the bike at the beginning, and then close to the end of the bike, I did another one. Did I do two? I may have just did one on the bike.
What did you drink on the bike?
A Tailwind.
Okay, so you had how much of
side
it did you have?
Calories there, too.
How much did you have, though?
Oh, I probably only drank a half a bottle.
Okay, I mean, the bike ride there is 40 minutes, give or take.
Yeah, I only had like a half a bottle of and the gel. So
that's okay. I mean, I probably would have said drink a little bit more just because of the humidity.
Right.
But for your first race, the fact that you got a half a bottle in and you took a gel, that's impressive.
Okay.
Well done, bravo.
Yeah. He's meticulous. I mean, really, I mean that. I think that kind of stuff.
What about your cadence? What was your cadence on the bike? I'm just curious.
I'd have to look back. But
now I'm asking the real questions.
That is a good question. I'll look it up as we speak. But
and I'm asking that because it affects your run.
Yeah.
And that's why it's really important to pay attention to your cadence.
Mm-hmm.
Now, on a course like that, you know, with all the hills up, down, it's hard to maintain. But for somebody like you, who's more experienced, you should be better at shifting to be able to maintain your cadence. So go ahead and look that up.
Okay. Talk amongst yourselves.
And explain what cadence is.
There you go.
Okay. Cadence is how many times you turn your pedals over within a minute.
Yeah.
And ultimately, we're looking for a run cadence of 90 and a cycling cadence of close to 90.
Ugh. Yeah, I know. I've got a slow run cadence. I'm a plodder. So, well, let's talk about bike for a second, bike cadence.
Yes.
I've had this discussion 25 times with people.
Okay.
And everybody's got a different opinion.
Yeah.
Is there a bike cadence that is optimal for everyone, or is it individualized?
I think it's individualized, but 90 is a great number to shoot for.
Yeah.
You know, somebody like you who's bigger and more powerful, you might be able to get away with like 85.
Yeah.
But much lower than that, then you're really like stressing yourself more. You're just really powering through it. Not that you couldn't get away with that for a short bike, but it's going to affect you when you go to run.
Yeah.
And so since the goal is to be able to run well off the bike or bike so that you may run well, you just have to pay attention to that.
Yeah. And that, I've seen that. I mean, as he's looking that up, I've seen that get better as far as like even on when, and the good thing about my, the app that I use that controls my kicker is when you set the, when I set 220 on power on that ERG of, then I can look at my cadence.
Yes.
And I can increase my cadence right to that. And you see, when you're doing that, you can really see how these things relate to each other. Mm-hmm. Of, you know, if you drop down and you're doing your wattage is 220 and you're doing 80 cadence, it's a whole different thing than 90 cadence.
Yes.
Whole different thing.
Yes.
A lot easier.
Well, it's a different
90.
Workout.
Yeah.
It's a different workout and you're working a different system.
Yep.
And really, you know, for especially when you're doing long distance, having that cadence be a little bit higher, having it feel a little bit easier, maybe the power is a little lower, that's okay. Okay, I think Hal has a number. Nope.
Yes.
Yes, Hal has a number.
It's coming shortly. Let's see. Cadence was 83.
Cadence was 83. Okay, mm-hmm. So, you know, there's a little room for improvement maybe there.
That yeah. surprises me because you
– Oh, I started out.
You work higher cadences, don't you?
I was really low. I've made it faster. Improved or not.
But that's an area that you could work on. And I wanted to ask you that, mm-hmm. just kind of bring people's attention to cadence, because cadence is something that most people who are beginners don't ever look at, don't know about, aren't aware of.
Yeah.
But it's an important number.
I started out just a grinder.
Most people do.
Most people, yeah.
Don't feel bad.
Yeah.
So. And that's the two extremes, right? You say grind and spin. If you're a grinder, you're low. I mean, it's not your
70, 65, 70 cadence.
You're talking diesel.
Yes.
You're just torquing it through. And then you got spinners that, I mean, some people
they're going to be up over 100.
Yeah, I mean, they're just, and I'm like, man.
But usually there's also a point at which it's just not efficient. Mm-hmm. And so if your cadence is just way too high, you need to learn to shift.
Yeah.
So if you find yourself spinning all the time and your butt's bouncing on your seat, you need to shift.
Yeah.
It's kind of like driving a stick shift. For people who've ever driven a stick shift, you know, once you get over 3,000 RPMs, you need to shift.
Yeah.
All right. Continue on. What else you have from the bike?
Okay. No, that's really it for the bike. I mean, I don't have a lot of other. I guess, you know, if you want to get really technical on that bike, because the course has so many turns. How you accelerate into the turns. Some of the turns you turn and you start to go uphill.
Mm-hmm.
Other turns you are coming up a hill and then you've got to make a turn and go back downhill. So the course is very difficult to maintain speed on, which is mm-hmm. why when he said his goal was to average 20 miles an hour, I'm like, I'm sure he could average 20 miles an hour. But on that course, you've got to really accelerate well out of these turns.
And I found myself, after the turn, standing out. I was out of the saddle.
Because maybe you weren't quite in the right gear to be able to accelerate.
Yeah.
And that's where with the cadence, if you can get your cadence up a little bit higher, that allows you to accelerate. Mm-hmm. Then you can shift back down into a harder gear and get the cadence back, you know, into the 85, 90 range.
Yeah.
But it's... if you don't know the course and if you aren't used to racing like mm-hmm. that, it's a lot to think about.
Yeah. Yeah.
So transition. You said you spent a little bit more time in transition than you probably wanted.
Yeah.
To.
Yeah. I think both of them were over 2 minutes.
That's not bad.
Yeah. I would have
220, 230, does that sound? I did wear socks.
That's okay. Socks are okay.
So, so I put socks on after the swim.
I have a tip for socks and after the swim. So put your wet feet in your bike shoes, because that doesn't really matter. Your feet will dry out in your bike shoes.
Uh-huh.
Then when you come in, your feet are dry and you can get your socks on easier before you run.
And run shoes. Okay. Okay. That's good.
That's my little a little trick.
All the bike shoes.
Barefoot in the bike shoes.
Yeah, because you're not going to get blistered in your bike shoes. Mm-hmm. Now, running barefoot, you might get big blisters.
Yeah.
So that's why I stick my feet in, let them dry off in my bike shoes, mm-hmm. take them out. My feet are nice and dry. I can slip the socks on a lot faster. Granted, I usually am thinking about saving time, but still, it just makes it so much easier. It's one less thing to fight with.
How about clipping the shoes in pre- with the rubber bands.
Okay.
And all that.
Do you do that every day?
No.
Okay. Don't do that in a race.
Okay.
I always like to get my shoes securely on my feet so that I can run out of transition in my shoes.
Okay.
Because I feel like so many people run out of transition and lose a shoe that they have had elastic banded onto their bike when they leave their shoes on their pedals. Mm-hmm. They lose their shoe, then they've got to turn around, run backwards, and pick up that shoe. Did that save them any time? No. Are they totally flustered? Yes.
Oh, okay.
So that's I always say, unless you practice that a lot and are really good at it, don't do it.
Gotcha. Okay.
Cool. All right. So now you're on 2 feet running.
2 feet running.
Yeah. Seemed like you had a good run. I mean, you just kind of.
Yeah, I did.
Do you know what your cadence was?
Yeah. Stand by. Run, and that's something I hadn't really paid attention to yet, is my run cadence.
That's okay. Let's see what it was.
Let's just see here.
I'm just here to ask the questions.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's bad. All right.
But that was a 3-2.
We're looking at data.
Andy's race run. There we go.
Oh, well.
That was a run 3, walk 2.
Oh, yeah. So those, I look at the specific. Okay, yeah. So Kevin just mentioned, you know, when you're walking, if you take walk breaks, what's that doing to your cadence? And my comment to him was, if someone who I coach is taking walk breaks, I am looking at their cadence while they're running to see where they are. I don't look at the average cadence then, because that's really unfair.
Oh, okay, yeah. So my average was 158.
Oh, okay.
And my max was 174.
Okay.
Over a 5K, so.
Okay, so that's a little low.
Okay.
That's really low, because you are looking for 90, which would be 180.
Okay.
So that's something to pay attention to.
Okay, yeah.
So if you want to increase your cadence, you can work on your arm swing. The faster you swing your arms, shorten your stride a little bit, but turn it over, accelerate. Kind of like the same thing I'm talking about on the bike. If you put it in a little easier gear so you can get going, if you swing those arms a little bit faster, shorten the stride a little bit, you can turn it over a little faster.
Okay. So a little faster on the on the cadence.
Definitely. But, I mean, it was your first race. Okay.
Yeah.
So let's not be too critical. But I just thought, since we're learning here, that would be something good for you to look at in training.
Okay. My average heart rate was 149. Which my typical zone 2 is 131.
Okay.
So I was securely into zone 4 for the race.
Which is where you should be.
Yep.
So that was for the whole race? Was your average heart rate?
149.
Was 149? And normally, I never look at the average heart rate of an entire race. I always look at the bike and the run segment separately.
That was for the run. I'm
that
sorry.
That was just for the run.
That was for the run. I'm sorry.
Okay. Yeah. So typically, I like to see a 10-beat difference between the bike and the run. So if your run was 149, your bike should have been 139.
Let's see what the bike was.
While he's looking, explain why is it important to have a high run cadence?
Oh, because you fatigue yourself a lot less.
So it's about fatigue. And so efficiency will,
and yes, efficiency.
The efficiency will be trained.
Yes.
Your body will adapt to that.
My bike heart rate is 143.
That's great. Okay, so this is really, so your bike heart rate was 143 and your run heart rate was 149.
139.
Okay, so basically, because of your skill on the bike, you were able to ride a lot harder than you were able to run, is what that's telling me.
Okay.
You know, and again, that's something, that's why you always have to look at it on an individual basis. I can't say, oh, everybody's going to be here. So for you, I'm not surprised that your bike heart rate was higher than your run heart rate, but ideally you can work on your running and get your running so that you're running a little bit better, a little bit faster, and that heart rate will be, they'll be closer together.
Yeah.
The faster you are, or the better you are at both sports, the closer those heart rates will come. But in general, for most athletes, we're going to see a 10-beat difference between the bike and the run. The run being higher, the bike being lower.
Okay. Yeah, so I just started really running in June.
Okay. So, well, that's perfectly acceptable.
You know, I've run, but training hard, you know, doing the what I need to do to train for the run. So,
cool. So how about the overall experience?
It was fun. Yeah. Had a good time. Interesting group of people. So yeah. It was good.
That's an interesting way to say that.
Well, they're different. I mean,
they are.
Cyclists are different. Runners are different. Triathletes are different. I mean, yeah. It's a whole different breed of obsessive compulsiveness.
And there was a lot of happy people that they got to race.
Oh, yeah.
Definitely.
I bet.
Definitely. So it was good.
So, Coach Katie, anything else for Mr. Howe?
No, I think he did a really good job executing his first race. Yeah, I'm impressed.
So the next one, this Saturday.
Middle Tiger.
Oh, that's right. It is.
Mm-hmm. So.
I'll be out there cheering.
And did you defer Augusta to?
I'm just going to do it till next year.
Till the next Augusta.
Yeah. So any prep for this week?
For Middle Tiger? Well, you know the course, right?
Yep.
The trail run, really keep your eyes on the trail.
Oh, okay.
Because there are a lot of roots.
Mm-hmm.
And pick your feet up.
Okay.
A lot of people, you know, you're going to go into the run, you're going to be a little bit tired, and the first mm-hmm. portion is on the trail.
Okay.
So pick your feet up, watch the trail right in front of you.
Gotcha. Okay, cool.
That's my big tip there. On the swim, I would give yourself a couple of physical pointers to actually do to keep yourself calm.
Mm-hmm.
It's just the warm-up. You're just going for a little swim. I mean, it's your pool. It's where you train.
Home base, yeah.
So you should be a little bit more comfortable there just because of that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and try to pass somebody at the wall just for fun, like just to give yourself a challenge. If you see somebody, be like, I'm going to try to pass them at the wall.
Yeah.
Have fun with it, because really it is a game at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. It's not anything that should really make you stressed.
Okay. How about swim warm up beforehand?
I think that helps if you mm-hmm. have time and you're allowed to get in the pool, definitely mm-hmm. get in and do a little bit of a swim.
Okay.
And do like maybe one lap easy and one lap harder just to get your heart rate up a little bit before the race starts.
Gotcha. Okay. Cool. What? I noticed a lot of people were doing that at Andy's race. And
yes.
I just had too much going on.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to do. It's hard to find that time to get in. Mm-hmm. But any time that I have the opportunity where I'm actually early enough and not helping other people before a race, I always try to get in and do a warm-up.
Okay, cool.
So, Hal Mars, now you're a triathlete, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're proud of you.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
It hadn't been long since you, like I said, you started running, jumped in the pool. Hadn't been that long since you started cycling, honestly. So, you're...
No.
Your journey continues, man. You're doing a great job. So, Coach Katie, we appreciate you being here.
Thanks for having me.
You pulled two podcasts today.
Yeah.
Always fun.
Both of them with a lot of really, really good information. Appreciate everything you do for the triathlon community. And we just encourage you, if you are interested in doing a triathlon, go ahead and dip your toes in the water. Even though you may not be able to sign up for another race until 2021. Go ahead and think about that and take some of the tips that you've heard today from Coach Katie and Hal. And next thing you know, you'll be finishing your first triathlon.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yep.
Yeah, great job, man. Way to do hard things today like you encourage everybody else to do.
It was.
We just want to remind you, if you just give us a quick review, a little 5-star, if we're bringing any kind of value into your life, and join all the groups. Everything we do is for free. We'd love to have you be a part of us. And just remember, if you'll do the hard things today, tomorrow will take care of itself.